DynamoDB is a hugely popular NoSQL database that has tons of useful features. The problem is, it's hard to figure out how to get started. In this video, I'm going to explain the core concepts of DynamoDB and then walk you through the console to create a table and explain all of the settings. My goal here is not to make you an expert, but to give you a broad understanding of DynamoDB so that you can hit the ground running. All right, everyone, so let's start out by talking about what is DynamoDB. So DynamoDB is a managed NoSQL database that is optimized for performance at scale. So there's quite a few different points in this statement, so let's unpack this a little bit. First of all, starting with the fact that it is a NoSQL database. NoSQL standing for not only SQL. Traditionally in SQL databases, you have rows and columns and tables. Not quite the case with DynamoDB and NoSQL. Dynamo is a key value lookup store. So most of the APIs that you're going to be working with, you're going to be providing the primary key so that you can find the corresponding value. Now, it's great because it distributes your data across different partitions, and partitions can be different machines, either physical or virtual, so you get extra levels of redundancy there. So that's just the fact that it's a NoSQL database. Now, the fact that it's a managed database, what does that mean? Well, traditionally, if we had our own database, that means that we would have to maintain the hardware and do all the security patches and all the maintenance and updates and all that. But with DynamoDB, none of that is the case. It is a totally managed AWS service. So despite the fact that there are servers behind the scenes and storage volumes that are storing your data, all of that is completely opaque to you. You don't have access to, nor do you care, the details of what is going on under the hood of DynamoDB. So that's what it means when we talk about managed. And then finally, it is optimized for performance at scale. This is by far the most popular feature of DynamoDB and why so many people are running to it. It can essentially just scale out horizontally by adding more nodes to the cluster and separating your data out onto those nodes. So even if the size of the data that you're storing in your cluster grows, you're not necessarily going to be impacted on the performance side. Although there are some edge cases where this is not true, but I'll get to that in perhaps a different video. So again, that's why it's very, very critical for a lot of these large scale systems. It is optimized for performance at scale without any kind of degradation as you add more data. Now, secondly, it has high availability and durability. Availability means the amount of time that it is up. So DynamoDB has a 99.999% guaranteed uptime. That's the figure that's advertised on their SLA page or service level agreement. That doesn't mean a lot to us, so I kind of ran the numbers really quick. That translates to less than 5 minutes of yearly downtime or less than 26 seconds of monthly downtime. And again, the fact that it's a managed service means that a lot of these failures are completely transparent to you. So even though some hardware can be failing behind the scenes, you're not gonna necessarily see any performance degradation. You have, you know, a whole system behind the scenes that is gonna be maintaining your database to ensure it's always available and always running correctly. And the second point here is in terms of durability. So one of the key features is the fact that there is a level of redundancy. So DynamoDB will store multiple copies of your data across multiple nodes. So in the case that any one of these nodes fails, a separate node can take over and start acting as the primary. So if you're concerned about your data disappearing or the durability of your data in DynamoDB, that's not something you really need to worry about in this case. All right, so the next one isn't really a feature, but it's kind of a good to know when you're first approaching DynamoDB. It does require a little bit of a mental model shift. So DynamoDB is ideal for applications that have known access patterns. And this is very different if you're coming from the SQL world. Typically in that world, you start by modeling your data, defining all the constraints, yada, yada, yada. But with DynamoDB, one of the kind of caveats, if you start using it, is that you need to know how you want to access your data. Now, you can certainly have a general idea of how you want to access it and, you know, build out your tables as you would. However, you may find yourself in a situation where you're not able to access your data in the way that you want. So as a trade-off in terms of the guaranteed horizontal scalability and ultra-fast performance, you need to know how you want to access your data. So it's important to kind of build a good schema out prior to getting getting started, especially if this is going to be like a production use case that is going to last for many, many years, you really need to get this right the first time. However, if you do make a mistake, it's not impossible to switch it over by replicating your data to a new table. Anyways, so that's one of the concerns that I wanted to call out, or one of the points that I wanted to call out. Know your access pattern before you get started. I have a whole video on this, by the way. I'll link that in the comments or the description below on how to design your table and how to choose the right partition keys. All right, so the next one is in terms of access. So you access DynamoDB through their APIs and ORMs. So APIs can be communicated with RESTfully, although people don't really call the APIs directly. Typically, it's through an ORM or an object relational mapper. Now, depending on the language that you're programming in, there's different ORMs. So for example, in Java, there's DynamoDB mapper, which is very, very popular. And in Python, which is the other language I primarily use, the most popular one is Bodo3. So those are the options in terms of accessing DynamoDB. Now, in terms of authorization, it is authorized through IAM, which is Identity and Access Management Service. I also have another video on this that I'll put down below. But essentially, it's the permissioning system of AWS. If you're coming from SQL, we're used to passing around credentials with a username and password. That is not necessary in DynamoDB. Everything is managed through IAM, so you need to have a user that has the correct permission in order to access the specific API that you're trying to access. So this makes it a lot easier. You know, if someone leaves the company or your credentials get leaked, you don't have to worry about changing usernames and passwords and impacting production applications. You can just simply revoke IAM permissions, and it's easy as pie. So that's what it looks like from the access and authorization front. So my next point is my most favorite feature of Dynamo, and not enough people talk about this, unfortunately, but it integrates really, really well with other AWS services. And this is really where the strength comes in of using AWS and using Dynamo in conjunction with it. So for example, you can set up DynamoDB streams, which allow you to capture item level changes on the records that exist in your table. And then you can pipe that into a Lambda function so that anytime something changes, you can get a batch of notifications that are delivered to a Lambda function, and you access them through the parameters that are passed in. So you can do like diffs, or you can use that to create dashboards by incrementing a dashboard somewhere else. This is just one example. You can also integrate it with S3 to do automatic table exports. You can pipe the data to Kinesis. Kinesis is a data streaming pipeline, so you can do temporal queries or time-based queries on your data as it is passing through the stream. It really allows for the world to be your oyster in terms of building applications that have some very interesting behaviors. So that's one of my kind of favorite silent features of using DynamoDB that not enough people are talking about. Next, we have the fact that it is a cost-effective usage-based payment model. So coming from SQL, you may be used to just paying for a fixed amount based on how many nodes that you need, and you're paying, of course, the hardware for that particular node. Now with DynamoDB, there's two primary cost models. The first one is on-demand. Of course, you're always paying for storage, by the way, so that is regardless of which model you're using. The first model is on-demand, so you pay as the requests come in. This is suitable for like spiky workloads where you're not really sure what your access patterns are going to be, or it can just be at random times the day. Less cost effective than the next one, which I'm about to describe, which is the provisioned mode. So in the provisioned mode, you can basically tell Dynamo at any given point in time, I want the capacity of my cluster to be X amount. And the X amount is through read capacity units and write capacity units. I'm going to get to that in the demo. But it's basically the idea that depending on the time of day or the schedule that you set up, DynamoDB will have a different amount of resources available to it. So it'll always have predictable performance. And the cool thing is you can set this up to auto scale. So as your traffic changes over time, you can set up your provisioned capacity to be like 30% of whatever the highest number is of your usage at that moment. And this can change from minute to minute. So that's why it's an attractive feature. It's cheap, cost effective, easy to understand. A lot of people like it for that reason. Okay, so I think that's pretty much it for what is DynamoDB. Now, there's a couple key concepts that I wanted to cover here just because a lot of the demo isn't going to make sense unless you understand this. So I just want to briefly cover these four items: tables, items, attributes, and indexes. So let's start with tables here. So pretty simple. Tables are a collection of items. I think of a table in DynamoDB the same way as I think of a table in SQL. And tables are a collection of items. So if we bring up this example really quick, we have what looks like just a very simple DynamoDB table here. So the items are the record. So every one of these guys here, every row that I'm highlighting on is a item. And within that, items are collections of attributes or key value pairs. So these are essentially the columns. So the key creation date and the value, you know, 2019-09-30, that is a attribute for this item with account ID 1. All right, so just some housekeeping to understand the partitioning structures and like how primary keys work and all that. So in Dynamo, it's pretty similar to SQL. So you have this notion of a primary key. And so let me just show you this really quick. So a primary key can consist of a partition key and sort key. So let me kind of describe what's going on with this data here. So your partition key doesn't necessarily have to be globally unique if you are pairing it with a sort key. So you can see in this example, we have account ID 1 and then a value here. So this combination here, the fact that account ID is 1 and the creation date is a unique value, we can't have any other duplicates of this, right? That would not be allowed in this schema type, which is using a partition key and a sort key. Whereas in this example here, you can see that we have account ID repeating twice, right? Two records or two items with account ID, but the creation dates are different for both of them. So that means you can have a duplicate here. So in this format, your primary key consists of partition key and sort key. A sort key allows you to do kind of range-like operations if you provide a partition key. So you can do a query, for example, on account ID 2 and say, give me all the records with account ID 2 and the creation date is greater than October 1st here. So you can do that kind of stuff, or it starts with 2019. So you can do these different range-like operations based on the sort key. So there are some advantages of having that. And the other option is if your data is structured in a way, or your access pattern is structured in a way where your partition key is always going to be unique. So if we had, you know, no duplicates here, so no second record with the number 2, then we can just use the partition key. So we don't have to use the sort key anymore. Really, that's up to you in terms of how you want to structure your access patterns or how you want to access your data in general. But that is the overall idea in terms of primary keys, partition keys, and sort keys. All right, over here we have attributes. Attributes can be, like I said, arbitrary pairs of keys and values. So you can have details key here, and the value can just be any JSON that you want. There's different data types that you can have in DynamoDB, not very similar to what you'd have in SQL, though. You're not going to see like varchars of 255 or anywhere, but it's much more simple. So you can have strings, booleans, lists, sorted sets. There's like 5 or 6 different ones that you can choose from, numbers, of course. However, you can also store like these very complex objects in JSON form. And it's there is a limit on the amount of data that you can store in each record. However, it's pretty liberal, and I don't expect anyone to really breach that unless you have some ridiculous use case. So that's kind of what's going on in terms of attributes. Now, there's this other idea of indexes in DynamoDB, and the most popular one is called a global secondary index. So remember when I told you that DynamoDB is great if you know your access patterns? Well, in this case, if you think about it, if the only way we can query our data is based on the primary key over here, how do we answer a question like, what are all the accounts that have an origin country of USA, right? How would you answer this question? So one way is doing what's called a scan operation, where you just like read over every record that exists in your table. And then you do like what's called a filter expression, and you say origin country is equal to USA. This is bad because you have to iterate over your entire table. And if your table gets really, really large, then this is going to be very inefficient and cost ineffective, because despite the fact that only 2 records here exist with USA, you're going to be charged read capacity units or read costs on every single row that you're iterating over. Now, if you want to not do that, which most of you should not do that, you can use a global secondary index, or also called a GSI. I have a video on this as well that I'll put down below that you can watch and learn about how this works. But it essentially makes it such that instead of querying on just the partition key and sort key, we can query on any other columns. So in this case, origin country. So we can say, give me all the items with origin country USA, and the query will be very efficient because we have an index on it and we're only looking at these two records, right? The first one and the third one down here. So that is a little bit about the core concept. So tables, items, attributes, and indexes. So just to recap, I mean, this whole thing is a table. This is an item, these horizontal records here. The key value pairs are attributes, and indexes make it more efficient for us to access our data. So I think I covered most of what I wanted you to know about, or kind of the basics of Dynamo. Let's hop into the console now, and I want to walk you through a bunch of the different concepts there and show you some of these things in action. So let's head over there now. All right, guys, so here we are in the AWS console. So let's get started by going to the DynamoDB section. Just going to go to the top there and click on DynamoDB. This should bring us to our default page. Okay, so this is the default page of Dynamo. We can see here if you don't have any tables, this is by default what you'll see. If you already have some tables, you may see a different view with just the tables listed out in front of you here. This is just a general welcome page. It has some great links to what is Dynamo, getting started, how to create your tables, accessing a whole bunch of great stuff to look through and watch. We're not going to do that here, obviously. What we want to do in this case is to create a table and get started with this. Now, I do want to point out that what I am using here is the new version of the DynamoDB console experience. In fact, the whole of AWS seems to be switching to this new UI that has different styles, basically what you see in front of you now. If you don't see this, there'll be a ribbon up top that'll say, I think it's in blue or green, that says, do you want to switch to the new one? You can just click that to see what I see. But again, I'm in the new version that is currently available as of July 2021. So what we're going to do first here is just go ahead and click on this orange button here that says create a table, and then it's going to ask us for a whole bunch of details. All right, so we see here that it's just telling us that a little bit about DynamoDB here on the top. The second thing that we need to specify here is table name. So table name. So let's call this, I don't even have an idea planned here. Let's call this the orders table. Oh, one other thing that you should know about, make sure that you're in the right region by going up to the top right here. Pick the one that's closest to you. Keep in mind that Dynamo tables are region specific. So I'm in US East 1. If I create a table name here called orders, I can also go to US East 2 or Asia Pacific, AP East 1, and create a different table also called orders. So it is region specific. So make sure that you have the right one selected here when you're doing this. Okay, so in terms of partition key, this is what we were discussing before. So we need to choose our partition key. So let's call this order ID. Now it's at this point that we also have a type here that you can specify, but let's keep this as string. It's at this point in your Dynamo journey that you need to make an important decision, because this cannot be changed later, which is one of the things that kind of bites people. You can't add a sort key after the table is created. So I guess what to ask yourself is, does your access pattern require your order ID to be duplicated as the partition key? So are you ever going to be in a scenario where you're going to have like order ID 1 that has multiple records with order ID 1 and 1 being the partition key? If that is true, then you need a partition key and sort key. If that is not true, so every record in your table will have an order ID that is unique, then you can just use the partition key. You don't need to use the sort key. I'm going to create one for this, and we're just going to use creation date here. Just to make this super simple, because I want to show you some examples of using the query operations and the scan operations and using filter expressions. So again, we're going to set that as string here, so that's fine. And then there's some settings here. Let's go to customize. I'll explain some things as we go here. So these were the two read and write modes, or sorry, not the two read and write modes, the two capacity or cost modes. I don't want to say they're just cost, because they also affect in some ways the performance of your database. So you can always change between these, by the way. It's not putting anything in stone if you go with one or the other. So like I said, on demand simplifies billing by paying for the actual reads and writes your application performs. This is very attractive for a lot of people. You can see some things disappeared here after I clicked this, but it's not great for use cases where you have a pretty predictable traffic pattern that looks like, you know, a wave where it goes up during the day and down at night. On demand isn't going to be great for you. You're going to end up paying more at the end of the day. In that case, you want to use provisioned. So provisioned makes it such that a whole bunch of other options become available for us. So let me just explain to you what's going on here. So like I kind of touched on before, there's a concept of read capacity units and write capacity units. So this top section here that I'm highlighting, this is all read, and this section here is for write. They're clones of one another. It's just one is read, one is write. So here we can specify if we want auto scaling on or off. So if you set it to off, you have a fixed amount that just stays that way. So you're always going to have 5 read capacity units. So let me do that for both actually. So now in this format, we're going to have read and write capacity fixed at 5. So if you imagine like a cross section on a graph, the capacity would be a straight horizontal line across the x-axis. Now, say for example, we want auto scaling on read. Say we have a scenario where maybe our table just stores a whole bunch of config and we're never really writing to it, or very, very rarely. We may want to minimize our write capacity here, but we may want to have auto scaling read capacity. So we're going to tick this on. And what this is asking us here is, what is the floor? So what is the lowest that you are willing to go in terms of your capacity units? You can put this to whatever you want. So I never want it to go below 5. So I always want to have enough capacity in my DynamoDB table to satisfy 5 read units. And then you have maximum here. So you can set this to an enormously high number. I think like 100,000 is the max or something. And then you say here, before we get into that, actually, maximum is just the maximum you're willing to go to. So if, for example, you go over 100,000, it's not going to auto scale past that. So it's a good kind of protection mechanism for you. If you're confused on this, I have a whole video on this topic of auto scaling and how all this works. You can go watch that to learn more. Anyways, I'm going to leave this as it is for now. Auto scaling is fine. We're never going to hit this, so it doesn't really matter. Now, secondary indexes. So the last time I checked, a local index can only be created at the time of table creation. Local index is like that sort key. So it allows you to do range-like queries on a data field. So if you have another field similar to what we had before, like creation date or updated date, you can create a local index on that so that you can query on, you know, range-like attributes. And then there's global secondary indexes, or GSIs for short, which is what we were just talking about a few minutes ago in the PowerPoint. You can add these at any time. I think the limit right now of global indexes is like 20 or so that you can add to your table. Keep in mind that there is additional cost implications of using GSIs. So it's not free. Just to kind of set up your table where a GSI is supported, it has to kind of duplicate your data in this bizarre way. So you're going to have to pay for additional storage and pay for additional access when you want to query on the GSI. So keep that in mind. Again, I have a whole video on GSIs that you should watch. Okay, so going down here, encryption at rest. If you want to encrypt your data while it's sitting in the database, that's fine. I'm not going to do that here. I'm just going to leave this as default. So I'm going ahead and going to click on create table now. So often this takes a couple minutes to actually create the table. It's going to provision everything onto some database somewhere. And then once it is available, the status will change to either available or running. We will see in a moment here. So you can refresh this. Oh, there. Okay. So I was wrong. It's active. This screen just kind of gives you a brief summary of what's going on. You can click on the table here to go to the, I believe this is the items section. Sorry. This is the new screen that shows you the summary information. I'm sorry if I kind of fumbled through this, by the way. This is a brand new UI that I'm really not used to. I'm used to the old one. But this is kind of your maintenance page, I assume, in this new format. So it gives you some details on what's going on. So your partition key, your sort key, your capacity mode. There's also some alarms that can be activated. The indexes you have, whether or not you have DynamoDB streams enabled, point in time recovery enabled, time to live enabled. I'm going to get to all these features in a couple minutes here. Replicated regions, encryption, basically all the metadata about this table. If you go over to the indexes section now, this tells you more about the indexes. So like I said, you can always create a global secondary index anytime after the table is created. And then you can also specify read and write capacity on that index that is separate from the capacity that is on your table. So if you expect a lot of queries on your secondary indexes, you can have different read and write capacities allocated to it. And then in terms of monitoring, you know, this probably won't show a lot because I just created this table, so it has nothing here. But essentially, it gives you some key metrics to monitor. So your read usage, your read throttles. Throttles occur when you are trying to use more capacity the Dynamo has allocated to you. So this is an important metric to watch. Then, of course, this is the write usage. Same thing, just for write. And then in terms of latency, usually you'll see like, you know, less than 10 milliseconds on gets, puts pretty much the same. Query can be different depending on how much data is being returned back. But overall, very, very low performance, which is good to see. And then some other details here, time to live, we'll get, actually, I'll just explain this now. So time to live is the idea that you can automatically evict data from your Dynamo table. So all you have to do is set a timestamp of when you would like it to be removed as a attribute. So it'll literally be like a column on your table. And when you're writing the record into your table, you say, this is the timestamp. And when this thing is enabled, DynamoDB will automatically attempt to remove that once the time is hit. So I believe the guarantee is within 48 hours. So it is not guaranteed to be exactly or precisely removed at that moment. It is just a best effort scenario. All right, so more errors, actually. This is a good thing to be aware of. System errors for write and user errors. Also conditional check failures if you're using concurrent updates or you're attempting to update concurrently on your table. Not gonna go into this too much, but just keep an eye on this. This should never really happen. You shouldn't really see system or user errors. If you do, you have a problem and you should probably contact AWS support or read about what each of these things actually mean. All right, so that's it for the monitoring section. In terms of alarms, actually, you can create some custom alarms based on attributes of your table. So, you know, if you breach a certain read capacity or you have a certain number of errors, you can go and do that here. Also, this other feature, contributor insights, this kind of just gives you metadata about access patterns on your DynamoDB table. So the number of queries or the number of get item requests by item ID. So if you have something like order ID 1 and it has a lot of queries for it, it'll show in this section here, but I'm not gonna enable this since it does have extra cost implications. All right, so next one is global tables. So let me just quickly explain this. I'm not gonna actually create one here, but global tables is just the idea that I mentioned before that, you know, we have a specific region that we are creating this table in. Now, what happens if someone wants to access this table from maybe they're in Europe, right? That means they have to make a network call that is going to span across the Atlantic Ocean there. And that's obviously going to be a lot slower. So ideally, if a customer is from Europe, they should be accessing the table in, you know, one of these Europe regions. So the most popular one is EU West 1. However, that is not the case here because our table is in US East 1. So global tables is the idea that we can have multiple representations of the same table across different regions and automatically synchronize that data across them. That's the idea of global tables. So like it's saying here, you can replicate this data into a different region. So in the example I was just giving, maybe into EU West 1, and then your clients can query either of these replicas. Well, I guess the EU West one is the replica, and the one in US East one here is the master. But that's the feature. So it's great if you have global applications that aren't stack specific and you want to get some increased performance, you can replicate that data out to multiple different regions. Okay, so that is it for global tables. In terms of backups, you can enable point in time recovery, which is PITR. So if you have this enabled, like it says here, point-in-time recovery provides continuous backups of your DynamoDB data for up to 35 days to help you protect against accidental writes or deletes. So this feature makes it so that you can, you know, do kind of the equivalent of a Windows system restore, where you're restoring your table to a particular moment in time. So it's a really interesting feature that I think most people should have enabled, to be perfectly honest with you, because it really protects yourself from introducing some kind of like backwards incompatible change, or maybe someone accidentally like nuked your table. You wouldn't have any way to get it back, but with PITR, you absolutely do. You can also do on-demand backups. So, you know, if you're going to do some kind of update, you can just take a snapshot of it and you can restore if you have a created backup, which we don't in this case. Okay, so that is it for backups. In terms of exports and streams, this is a new feature actually, so you can do exports to S3 if you'd like, on demand essentially. And you can also do, this is also a new feature, export to a Kinesis data stream. This is kind of what I was talking about in the PowerPoint section. And then the DynamoDB stream as well. So changes, like it says here, capture item level changes in your table and push the changes to a DynamoDB stream. You can then access the change information through the DynamoDB Streams API. So super, super underrated features here that you should check out if you're building dashboards or you just want to capture item level changes. So like the before and after of a record. It's great for creating an audit table, by the way, which is something I have a video on that you should check out on my channel. So that's what's going on there. Additional settings. I don't think there's too much that we need to know about here. Yeah, if you want to change your read and write capacity, this is where you can do it later. Click on edit, brings you to this page, and you can modify it. Just go back really quick, additional settings. And time to live. So if you want to enable time to live, you need to tell it what field or what column name you want to run it on. And it also gives you a preview here so you can kind of test whether or not you're about to blow away your table or not accidentally. So a good feature to have. And then, of course, if you want to add encryption, you can also do that. And then tags, you can tag your table for some easier access. Oh, by the way, this is the way to revert to the old page. You can come here and I don't want to click this anymore. I don't want to get used to the old stuff because it's going away. But this is how you go back if you want to temporarily. All right. So that's a little bit of a tour of the table section. I do want to show you the items section. This is where we create our items. So this is a list here of the number of tables that we have available. So we have an orders table. And so this is all different now. Wow. This looks like completely wacky. So I want to create an item now. Okay, so I think the way that you have to do it, how do you create items now? Here it is. Sorry, I don't know why that took me so long, but if you want to create an item, you can do so here, or you can do it programmatically. Let's just show you a quick little example here. So this is using the DynamoDB JSON. So there's different types here. S is for string, N is for number, B is for Boolean, and there's like L for list or SS for sorted set. A couple different ones. I don't like to use this view unless you really want to specify the types, which in some cases, it's a good idea. Or you can just click on this guy to give you just a typical JSON and it'll do its best to auto detect the types. You can also have a form like you have here. So this is actually pretty handy. So you can add new stuff here. So let's say order ID. Yeah. And let's say 2021. What's the date today? I think it's the 15th. So 07-15. So we're going to click on create item. This should only take a second. Okay. So let's just go back and create a second one here. So order ID 1, and let's do the same thing, except we'll do this in the future. So let's say this is the 20th of July. And click on create item there. So notice here that I'm able to create two records with the same key for order ID 1. But the primary key is a composite one because I set the range key in the beginning. So just as a quick example, if I try to go and create another record with this combination, so one and this value, it's going to fail and tell me that it's not allowed. So the only reason this is working is because we set the partition key and sort key combination when initially setting up our table. All right, so this doesn't look too impressive right now, but we can do some like just basic operations to get the point across. So you can do scans here. So scan is just give me everything. And then you can do a filter here as well. So you can say filter, you can put in the attribute name, let's say creation dates, and we're going to say string and equal to, and just take a look at some of the settings here. There's a whole bunch of things that you can start with or use to filter down. This is, by the way, what we're doing here is equivalent to writing a filter expression programmatically. So everything that you're seeing here, like all the types, all the conditions, all the values, the same thing could be done using the filter expression as part of the scan operation or the query operation as well. So we're going to say equal to, and then let's say 2021-07-15, right? 07-15, and this should only return the first one. Yep. So you see that. Okay, perfect. So let's reset. Yeah, let's take that out. So that's it for scan. Gives you everything and it applies the filter afterwards, which is fine. And in terms of queries, so queries are a little bit different. Notice that you can only specify some very key fields here. So the first one is it's asking us for our order ID, which is partition key. So that is one in our case. And the second thing here is optional. Creation unit is optional. So we can say just run. So this will give us back both records, right? Because they both have order ID one. And then we can also add a sort key now. And we can change the, well, you don't actually even have to put a value in. You can just say to sort this descending. By default, it's sorting ascending. So you do it descending, you get that data back that way. And then you can, like, say we only want this record here, assuming that there's like five other columns with more data. I'm just going to copy that, put that in here, and now we'll only get that one back here. So that's what's going on. And the way this is different than doing a filter, by the way, you can do this exact same thing with the filter, but using the index, you get constant time lookup. So DynamoDB knows exactly where this record is in its storage. Uses like a consistent hashing storage ring. So it can quickly find out where the data is located and go and grab it, as opposed to having to do any kind of, you know, lookup across a broad set of data. So those are some of the operations that you can do here. And you can see here, there's like different things that you can do in terms of comparison operations. So for example, if we do begins with, we're only gonna get that same record back. And then we can do like begins with 2021. So this is neat to do like time range lookups. If you care about like, what are all the orders created in this year for a particular customer, you can answer those types of questions, click on run and everything gets returned. So pretty cool stuff here. I wanna just go back really quick and just show you, go to tables and show you the monitoring page now, because it should have some data on it after messing with this for a little bit. It updates every 5 minutes or so. So you can see here, very, very low numbers. I don't even know if you can tell. Maybe if I zoom, no, it doesn't work. You can tell there's like a little blip there. We're using very little capacity, so not really much to see. And then in terms of latencies, this is just our initial latencies on our get calls, very, very low. So 18 milliseconds here, and the query was lower. And you know, scan was very low as well, just because we have such little data in our table. Also, some other stuff here that you can take a look at, return counts, blah, 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 blah. Nothing really more to look at. Now, I did want to talk about some other features here on the left-hand side. So PartyQL Editor, this is a new feature, allows you to do SQL-like queries on your data. I wonder if they have any samples, actually. Probably, right? If I like, yeah, scan table. Yeah, that looks good. Yeah, so select star from orders. So you can do some SQL-y kind of things. Keep in mind, though, that it's still using the underlying APIs that you have access to. So the fact that, you know, you're doing select stars doesn't mean that, you know, somehow it's doing some magic stuff to make it efficient for SQL style operations. You're still going to have the same performance concerns, even if you're using this type of access format. So let's keep that in mind. Okay, so the other item is in terms of reserve capacity. So you can actually get a better deal if you purchase your reserved capacity. By the way, this only applies if you're using the provision capacity model. So you can purchase some upfront on a yearly cadence. I believe it's either 1 year or 3 years. You'll get a better bargain over time if you're confident that your access is going to be pretty consistent. You can pre-purchase to get that better deal. All right, and the last thing that I wanted to cover here, actually the second last, because I want to show you how to delete the table too. The last thing is something called DAX. It means DynamoDB Accelerator, DAX. It's essentially a caching layer that you can put in front of your DynamoDB table. Not going to show you how to do it in this tutorial. I just want you to know that it exists. And I have another video on it where you can watch a little bit more about it and learn how it works. So finally, I want to show you how to get rid of this thing, which is pretty easy. Just go to the table section, click on the table, and then go to delete. It's gonna, of course, ask you to confirm and delete everything. Create a backup if you want. You can go ahead and click on delete table now. You should be good to go. In terms of next steps to learn more, check out the playlist on the right for more DynamoDB concept videos. Another great resource is the DynamoDB book by Alex DeBrie. I'll put a link to it in the description section below.